Hi, 10th standard students. Good evening to all. Today's lecture will be on Ohm's law. In the previous lecture, I told you that there is a relationship between the potential difference across a conductor, the current flowing through the conductor, and the resistance offered by the conductor. These three quantities are related by Ohm's law. What is the statement of Ohm's law? Let us first give the statement of Ohm's law. At constant temperature, the potential difference across a conductor is directly proportional to the current flowing through the conductor. What is the symbol for potential difference? It is capital V. And what is the symbol for electric current? Yes, that is capital I. So, as per this statement, the potential difference across the conductor V must be proportional to what? The current flowing through the conductor. So, V is proportional to I. Why we have mentioned at constant temperature here? We have to understand that first. So, V is proportional to I, or V is equal to a constant into I. That constant of proportionality only is called by the name electrical resistance of the conductor. This is the electrical resistance of the conductor. So at the end of this Ohm's law verification, we will come back to what is meant by the resistance of an electrical conductor. And we will also explain why we have mentioned the temperature is constant. So you are going to understand these two facts only at the end of the verification of the Ohm's law. Shall we verify the Ohm's law now experimentally? Yes. So today I will explain how to verify Ohm's law theoretically. Then in the regular class while doing the practicals, I will take you to the physics lab and I will demonstrate once again how to verify Ohm's law. Come, let us verify Ohm's law. Are you able to see the circuit clearly? All of you? Good. Look at the circuit. What is this single device? Single device represented by we called as cell. Okay. How many cells are connected in series in this picture? Is it 3 or 4? Good. That is 4 cells. 4 cells are connected in series. So, combination of these 4 cells act like a battery. Then, what is the name of this device represented by capital R? That is the resistance of a conductor. So, let us consider it is a nichrome wire, nichrome alloy. It is an alloy, a wire made up of nichrome whose resistance is represented by capital R. The two ends of X, the two ends of R are X and Y. They are connected across one instrument represented by V. What is the name of the instrument? It is voltmeter. What for it is used? A voltmeter is used to measure what? The potential difference between the two ends of a conductor. Okay. Then in series, another instrument namely capital A. What is that instrument which is connected in series? That is ammeter. Okay, good. That is ampere meter. And what for it is used to measure which quantity? Electric current. It is in series with one device which is represented by K. K is a plug key, single hole plug key or switch. Now it is opened or closed? Yes, it is opened. Okay, it is opened. Then the other end of the key is kept opened. Can you see this circuit and tell me whether it is a closed circuit or open circuit? Yes, good. It is a open circuit because the battery is not connected. It is not linked to the circuit yet. Because one end here, the battery is one end and the other end of the key are not in contact. Only when you contact, then you can say that the circuit is closed. Also, when the key is closed only, it is called a closed circuit. So, now first I will close the key. So, this is the closed key. Now also the circuit is not fully closed. It is opened only. Now I am going to include only one cell. out of the four cells, I am going to include only one cell. You see here, by dotted lines I am representing by dotted lines that initially only one cell is included. What happens to the other three cells? Will they also be included in the circuit? No, because the other end of the three cells is still kept in open. Only one cell is included. So when one cell is included in the circuit and when the key is closed, now we can say that it is a closed circuit. So will there be a current flow or not? Yes, there will be a current flow in the circuit proportional to the battery's potential difference. So here a current is sent by the battery, and I is represented by the current sent by the cell or battery, and the current will be starting from the positive terminal of the cell and it will be completing terminating at the negative terminal of the cell. So when only one cell is included means the current will be proportional to the potential difference. This potential difference across the resistor is measured by the voltmeter. Now how many cells I have used, I will record in the form of a tabular column. So in the tabular column, what we are going to record, I will tell you once again. The first column is what? Number of cells used. In this case, how many cells I have connected now is only one. So I am going to write only one. What is the second column mentioned here? The current flowing through the wire. Which instrument is used to measure the current? Ammeter. For example, let us say that the current which is measured by the ampere meter is 0.1 ampere. So ampere unit is written in bracket. 0.1 ampere is the current flowing through the circuit corresponding to one cell, and the voltmeter reading will give you the potential difference across the end x and the y of the resistance. For example, I will assume that this is 1.5 volt. Volt unit every time we need not write, because in the table header it is given that volt as a unit. Okay, next I will remove this connection and I will include two cells. Now how many cells I am going to include? Two cells. So you see that here there are two cells included. So when I include two cells in the circuit, naturally the current will be more than the previous case. So I will assume when number of cells included is two, for example I will take the current flowing through the circuit is double, that is 0.2 ampere. Then naturally the potential difference across the resistance should also have been increased. That is measured by the voltmeter. For instance, I will take that it is 3.0. This is all for example I have taken any number. Actual experiment in the physics lab when you do means whatever is recorded must be given by the instrument reading. Okay. Next, I will include three cells. So when three cells are removed, so this wire is removed and it is connected here. So three cells are connected in the circuit. For that, let us say, for example, the current passing through the resistor is 0.3 ampere. Proportionately, you measure the potential difference with the help of the voltmeter. And let us say that this is 4.5 volt for example. Okay. And the fourth case, how many cells we can include maximum in this circuit is four. So the fourth cell is now included, the fourth cell. So totally four cells are in the circuit. No, the current should have increased. So when four cells are included, let us take the current in the flowing through the resistor is 0.4 ampere. Corresponding to that, what is the potential difference across the resistor? Let us say this also is increased. So this is 6.0 volt. So when you do this experiment in the physics lab, you will have to go on changing the number of cells and corresponding potential difference across the resistance and the current flowing through the resistance, they have to be recorded in this tabular column. And what is the final column is meant for? You see, the final column, we have to find the ratio of the potential difference to that of the current. Is it not? Okay. Now in the first case, what is the potential difference? The potential difference is, see here, the first case I will write here. So for the first case, V by I ratio, V by I. So what is V here? 1.5, is it not? V is 1.5. So 1.5 divided by how much is the current? 0.1. So this is 0.1. So this multiplying both by 10, this will become what? 15 by 1. And this is equal to 15. So in the second case, so what is V by I? V by I is equal to what? 3 divided by 0.2. So this is 3.0 divided by 0.2. So this is equal to 30 by 2 is equal to 15. Now in the third case, V by I ratio. So V by I in the third case is what? 4.5 divided by 0.3. So this is 4.5 divided by 0.3. So this is equal to 45 divided by 3. That is also equal to 15. And in the last case, the V by I ratio is equal to 6 divided by 0.4. So 6.0 divided by 0.4, that is equal to 60 divided by 4, that is also equal to 15. Now these numbers I have assumed as if you see the ratio is exactly the same. So even when you do perfectly the experiment, you may get all the four values of V by I ratio the same only. Or if not very close, approximately all the four values will be around the average constant only. So from this experiment, we find that the ratio of potential difference to the current flowing through the conductor is always a constant. This is true only when the temperature of the conductor is maintained as constant. So I am going to explain at the end of this experiment why it should be mentioned as constant. Before that, you look at the statement once again. Can we all read the statement together? Yes, all of you? You? Yes. Will you all join with me? Come on, you start. Ohm's law. Okay, repeat. Ohm's law. Then what is the statement? At constant temperature. Good. Proceed. The potential difference across a conductor is directly proportional to the current flowing through the conductor. That means what? V is directly proportional to I, and V is equal to some proportionality constant into I, and that proportionality constant here is represented by the symbol capital R, where R is called the electrical resistance of the conductor. The electrical resistance of the conductor, and this is having a unit called as ohm. Ohm is a unit for electrical resistance, and it is represented by a symbol hat, just like a hat. Okay, so this is the hat to represent the unit as ohm. So in our observation, in the last column, what is the value of V by I? What should be the unit is now ohm. I can write, and the values which we have calculated here, I am going to put it in the tabular column. So this is 15 ohm, this is also 15. So each value of the resistance is 15 ohm. So we have verified Ohm's law. We have proved Ohm's law, which states that V by I ratio is always a constant provided the temperature is constant. Now I am going to explain why we have to mention about the temperature. See, resistance means what? Opposition. Opposition to whom? Opposition to the flow of the electrons. We have many times discussed what is the basic cause for the current flow in the wire or conductor. It is because of the free electrons. Though the electrons are called by the name free electrons, they are not actually freely moving inside the conductor. When they try to move from a lower potential to the higher potential on the way, other than electrons, who is also present in the conductor? Good. Yes, the positively charged ions. The positively charged ions, good. So these are very heavy, and what they are doing, they will be oscillating, vibrating up and down, and as a result, what happens? The free electrons, due to the resistance, that is due to the vibrations of the ions, they will go and undergo collisions. They will undergo collisions with the ions. This will obstruct the free flow of the electrons. That is why it is called as electrical resistance. Now what will happen if you heat a conductor? If the temperature of the conductor is suddenly increased, means what will happen? These ions will absorb the heat and they will vibrate vigorously. When they vibrate vigorously, what will happen? More opposition will be offered to the flow of the free electrons. That is why this relationship V by I will be constant provided the temperature is constant. That is why the statement begins with a constant temperature. Have you all understood? I hope you must have understood. So this experimental observation, tabular column and the calculation, have you all understood? Shall I erase the tabular column? Okay. So the mathematical expression of Ohm's law can be written in three different ways. One way of writing Ohm's law is V equal to I into R, the potential difference. Okay. So from this equation, I is equal to what? V by R. So this is V by R. R is equal to V by I. So all the three equations are called as Ohm's law only. For solving the numerical problem, whichever quantity is asked, accordingly that particular formula you are supposed to use. So to remember this expression for voltage, current and resistance separately, there is one triangle called as magic triangle. Shall I explain to you what is the magic triangle? Yes, you see the magic triangle. This is a triangle. In this triangle, now I will divide this first into two portions like this. So this is a horizontal line. This horizontal line is used for division. Then again this portion is divided into two. You see here. So this portion is divided into two. So this vertical line is for what? Multiplication I am going to use. So this is a multiplication. This line is for multiplication and this line is for division line. Now I am going to write V, I, R, Vir. Okay, you remember this sequence V, I, R, Vir. Okay, suppose if you want to get an expression for the potential difference V, you close that V and look at the triangle's portion which is remaining. It is what? I into R. So are we getting this equation V equal to I into R? Good. Now I want to get an expression for the current I. So I will close that portion I and look at the remaining portion of the triangle. What is remaining? It is V divided by R. Is it not? Are we getting this equation V by R is equal to I? Good. Like that, what is the third expression? R, resistance. So which portion I have to cover now? R factor I should cover. You see here, I am covering this R. What is the remaining portion of the triangle? V by I. Are we getting R equal to V by I? Yes, this, that is why I said it is a magic triangle. You thought as R is going to do some magic, is it not? No, this is the easy way to remember Ohm's law. V I R means V. Put it in a triangle and the base line is the division line, vertical line is the multiplication. Okay. So if you remember this, it is well and good. Now in the experiment which we have done, we have tabulated some values for the potential difference under the V column and current under the I column. And now we want to verify Ohm's law graphically with the use of a graph. Now look at this graph. The current flowing through the resistor R in the circuit is taken along the x-axis. Along the x-axis, which quantity I have represented? The current flowing through the resistor. Current is expressed in which unit? Ampere. Okay. So 0.1 ampere, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4 up to 0.5 ampere. 5 points I have located. Then in the y-axis, you see this is the y-axis. Which physical quantity has to be represented is the potential difference across the resistance R. And it is express in which unit? Volt. So each centimeter I have divided into what? 1.5 volt. So this is 1.5 volt, 3 volt, 4.5 volt, 6 volt and 7.5 volt. Now you have taken the tabular column. No, look at the first one. What is the first one? when one cell is connected, what is the potential difference? Yes, it is 1.5 volt. What is the current corresponding to that is 0.1 ampere. So can you see, can you locate a point like this? So corresponding to 0.1 ampere, the potential difference is 1.5 volt. Corresponding to a current of 0.2 ampere, what is the potential difference we have recorded is 3 volt. Like that, for the other currents, 0.3 ampere and 0.4 ampere also, you locate the points on the graph. Now, you take a scale and neatly you join all the points. What should be the nature of the graph? Yes, it is a straight line. Good. And look at the straight line. Does it pass through the origin or not? That is very important to be noted. Yes, it is a straight line graph which is passing through the origin. Okay, how many points I have located actually on the straight line? 4 points. Okay, so any 2 points I am going to consider on this graph, any 2 points I am going to consider. You see the point which I am going to consider, you see that it is projected on the x-axis first. So x-axis, and this gives this difference. This difference is what this is denoted with the symbol delta I, that is change in current. So the change in current, the final value of the current divide, that is the final value minus initial value, and this is equal to what? 0.3 minus 0.2, and that is equal to what? 0.1 ampere. So the same 2 points I will project on the y-axis now. Y-axis. So these 2 points are projected on the y-axis, and this y-intercept, this is denoted by the symbol what? Delta V, the change. So this is a change in potential difference, change in the potential difference. So what is the change of 4.5 minus 3? So this is 4.5 minus 3.0. So this change in current is taken along which axis? Yes, change in current is taken along the x-axis. That is why this also can be written as delta x-axis, change along the x-axis. Similarly, this change in potential difference is taken along which axis? Good, it is y-axis. So how to represent? Very nice. That is represented by what? Delta y. Now, I will take the ratio. I will take the ratio change along the y-axis divided by change along the x-axis. And this is only called as slope of the curve. So slope of the curve or slope of the graph. In mathematics and physics, how to find the slope of any graph? It is the change along the y-axis divided by the corresponding change along the x-axis. So in this graph, what is the change along the y-axis is called as a change along the y-axis is equal to the change in the potential difference. How much value we have got? 4.5 minus 3 is how much? This is equal to 1.5 volt. 4.5 minus 3 is how much? 1.5. So I am going to substitute here. Substitute, okay? So this is also equal to delta V divided by delta I. And instead of a delta V, what value I am going to substitute is 1.5. And divided by, that is a volt, divided by, what is the change in the x-axis corresponding to is 0.1 ampere. So this is 15 by 1, that is equal to 15 volt per ampere, or this is equal to 15 ohm. How beautifully the value is coming, the same 15 ohm. See, already we have verified it by doing the experiment, by taking the readings in the voltmeter and the ampere meter. What is the last column of the tabular column? We have verified the ratio V by I is always constant. Now from graph also we have verified once again that the ratio of V by I is always a constant, and this constant only is named as what? Electrical resistance. So this constant only is called the electrical resistance of the nichrome wire, and its unit only is named after the physicist George Simmons Ohm is his full name, and he was a physics teacher in his school, and his name only is honored as the unit for electrical resistance. So Ohm is the unit for electrical resistance. From this Ohm's law expression, from this Ohm's law expression, what is the equation for the resistance R we have written? Good. R is equal to what? Good. R is equal to V by I. So, can anyone tell me how resistance can be defined? Can anyone try? Come on, you try. Good. Yes. The electrical resistance of a conductor is defined as a ratio. That's good. Ratio of what? The potential difference across the conductor to the current flowing through the conductor. Good. So, my dear students, at the end of Ohm's law, we have got a new definition for electrical resistance. The electrical resistance of a conductor R is defined as the ratio of the potential difference across the conductor to the current flowing through the conductor. Have you understood? Yes. What is the SI unit of resistance? Ohm. That is good. Chant that Ohm when you are silent at home. Okay, students, sir, I will erase the board. Shall I erase the board and go to the next topic? We are now be ready to solve some numerical problems, sir. Okay, students, sir.